So in 2014, WhatsApp was acquired by Facebook for $22 billion. Wii U was still a thing, and Bitcoin was priced at $320 in December. Now, what you have definitely missed is the release of the E5-2643 Xeon CPU, which has 6 cores, 12 threads, and runs at a base clock of 3.4 GHz. Now, the unique thing about this CPU is it can run with 2 CPUs in a single motherboard. Not all Xeons allow you to do that. And I wanted to test this configuration to see how it holds up with playing some modern titles released within the last 3 years. Now, I'm not going to be using an OEM motherboard because it doesn't include USB 3. The PCIe slots look so ancient, older than your grandmother, and also there's going to be a pain to configure. So I've gone down the Chinese route and I decided to pick up myself a dual socket Huanzu motherboard, which includes 2 sockets that supports 2 Xeons and also has 8 USB 4 DDR4 slots. And it also includes some nice features like support for M.2 and also 2 PCIe Gen 3 slots, although those speeds can vary between each slot. However, I am only using 1 graphics card. So by today's standard, this motherboard looks a little bit trash-tastic and I just don't really like the look of it. So I'm going to be doing a little bit of modifications to the heatsinks to see if I can make this look a little better. So I decided to remove the heatsinks from the motherboard, and after taking off a couple of screws, I then filed down the heatsinks and then added them back in again. And I think with the brushed aluminium look, it looks miles better than what it will look like before. And I think probably that's about as far as I'm going to go with it. Now isn't time to install the CPUs, and you're probably wondering, why did I choose that Xeon chip in particular? There are 2 reasons why. Number one is because the base clock is actually higher than most of the other Xeon chips out there, where its base clock runs at 3.4 GHz and boost clock can go up to 3.7. Of course, most Xeon chips cannot be overclocked, so that is not a bad speed to achieve. Also, it has 6 cores, 12 threads, and if I'm using 2 of these CPUs, that means I'm getting 12 cores and 24 threads within this PC. The second reason why is because this CPU is super cheap. You can pick this up today for around about $15 to $20 each. So for 2 of these, you can get them for $20. Comparing that to when it was first launched, the price was around about $1,500 each. So the depreciation, you're worried about your car depreciating, then you haven't seen this CPU yet. So I decided to use standard DDR4 4GB DIMMs running at 2400 MHz. The reason for that is because that's the highest speed supported by the Xeon chips, and I filled out all the bays, giving me a total of 32GB. Now, the thing you need to remember is you're probably going to have to take all of these RAM sticks out when you're booting the PC and add them in one by one, because then you're going to get a failure and a non-boot situation. Here I'm using 120GB as my boot drive for my M.2, and I also have a 2TB drive to store all my games. So how do I fit this monstrosity into a gaming case? Well, I had to find the biggest case I could possibly find on Amazon, and the one I came across was Ion's Pro Gamer. I have no idea who they are, but the case looked pretty nice anyway. It was the KZ-X model. I don't know if anyone's really familiar with this case, however, it does have glass side panels on all 3 sides, so you better make sure that your cable management on the back doesn't look like crap, because people will see it and they will comment and mention how badly you've cable managed your PC. Moving on to the top, you've got your power button, USB 2 and 3 and audio jacks. Unfortunately, there's no USB-C. You've got a nice filter there, which is magnetic and quite a nice touch. And looking on the back of the case, you have some nice ventilation where you can put dual exhaust fans in. Unfortunately, they missed a trick here and you can't install a vertical mount GPU, even though they've got the vents there, which is really odd to me. I don't know why they wouldn't allow you to have a vertical mounted GPU. Moving on to the inside, and you have tons of space. I mean, I can fit a nice radiator on the front for one of the CPUs, another radiator on the top for the other CPU, and still have enough space to add in additional couple of fans. Looking at the back, you have a couple of trays to install your SSDs, and then you also have a tray on the bottom to install a couple of hard drives, although I won't be using any of those because I have fully maxed out my M.2 drives and that's about as much storage as I need. But it's nice to have the option there. A nice touch that they've also added is the trays actually have a rubber mounting on the side, so it minimizes vibration while the hard drives are spinning up. Now for power supply, I have this really old 1000 watt Silent Pro Gold, which I believe is a pretty decent power supply. It is semi-modular, and the best thing about this is it has the right PCIe connectors for the graphics cards. I have two there, and also I have a 6-pin in case I need it. In addition to that, I also have two 2+4 pins for the CPUs, which I will absolutely need, and that is a rarity in modern PSUs. Now, I like to install my PSU first, so it was a simple case of just sliding it into the bottom of the case, making sure that I have the fan pointing downwards because you don't want your PSU venting inside the case. Again, there was a filter on the bottom to make sure that dust could be easily cleaned and minimized. Now you just pop in the IO shield, which was pretty straightforward and standard, and that popped in place pretty easily. And then simply installing the motherboard. So because I have everything already installed, the RAM, the M.2s, the CPUs, I didn't need to worry about doing all of that later on. And screwing in the motherboards, you need to make sure that you have the standoffs aligned perfectly with the holes on the motherboard, or else you could risk a short and a pretty nasty spark if you in the RAM slots come loose or they move around a little bit, and you may get some RAM errors. So use a fairly small screwdriver doing this so you make sure you don't over tighten them. So the graphics card I decided to use for this build is an RX 6700 XT. It comes with 12 gigabytes of DDR6 RAM, and this is an absolute bargain for what you're paying for. Yes, it probably costs around about $300, but you are getting bang for buck in terms of performance. And pairing this with this PC, well, it's yet to be seen because I don't think anybody has tested this on YouTube. And if you like this kind of content, please remember to like and subscribe, and I promise I'll bring some more crazy builds like this as well, including some more 3D printing if that's the kind of thing you like to see. Now, what you've all been waiting for, let's have a look at some benchmarks. So Battlefield 5 running at 1080p on high settings, and the game is running okay. I mean, it runs pretty well. However, there are frame time spikes, and the FPS is running from around about 150 to 50 FPS. So the FPS is a little bit all over the place when running Battlefield 5 at 1080p. So let's have a quick look at 4K and see if that improves things any better. Running Battlefield 5 at 4K, you can see I'm getting around about 75 FPS, with the lows around about 17. And yeah, the FPS does fluctuate quite a bit, and the frame time is
much worse than it was at 1080p. However, the game is still somewhat playable, I suppose. It could be better, and yeah, I wouldn't recommend this game for a dual CPU setup.
Now testing GTA 5, I have this game on 4K, high settings, and overall, most of the time I was getting around about 100 FPS, driving the car through the city, you know, it would drop to around about 70, but overall, the performance was absolutely brilliant, and there was no issues with running this game whatsoever. So yeah, it runs really well with a dual socket CPU on GTA 5. Now, I decided to try out Call of Duty Warzone. I think it was Season 5, and this was on high settings. FPS was shockingly low for this game, which I didn't really understand. And in all honesty, I didn't really understand this game either. I am a Modern Warfare 2 player. I play that game to death. And this one, I just don't get what's going on. I'm jumping out of a plane with Nicki Minaj, not even in military gear, just in her dancing outfit, I suppose. So yeah, I don't get this game, and I was getting around about 40-50 FPS. Shoot me if you want. Now on to Cyberpunk 2077, and I really thought on this game actually the performance was going to be terrible, but I was pleasantly surprised. I was getting well into the 80-75 FPS region. Granted, I did only do this test in the benchmark mode, so it might be slightly different when I go into the gameplay, but overall there was no issues, and it was probably the best performance I've had with the whole lineup of rubbish PCs I've already tested so far. But this is really good, and I'm very impressed. I may do additional testing moving forwards. Hogwarts Legacy, game released around about February of this year, so fairly recent, and a pretty demanding game. But overall, again, you know, we were getting around about average FPS of 48. This was on high settings at 4K, and the game looks brilliant. No slowdowns, no real choppiness to speak of like we saw in Battlefield 5. So it seemed like the game had been more optimized for more cores, I suppose, at lower core frequencies. I'm not entirely too sure. Maybe you guys can let me know in the comments what you think is going on here. But yeah, overall it's a good result. It's not groundbreaking, it's not a 60, but I'll take it. And the final game in the lineup is of course Starfield, which only released about a week ago. And unfortunately, I think I left VSync on at 1080p, so it was capped at 60 FPS. But overall, the game performance was really smooth. There was no frame drops or anything like that to speak of, even when I got into busy areas or there was quite a lot of shooting and fighting going on. So yeah, I mean, again, it's not 120 FPS or anything ridiculous like that. 60 seems to be performing pretty well. And then moving on to 4K, and yes, the frame rate does drop quite a bit from here, and we do get around about into the 30 FPS regions. But bearing in mind, PS5 and I believe Xbox Series X also perform around about the 30 FPS region at 4K, so it's comparable to those systems. And yeah, I mean, this game looks absolutely stunning in 4K, so if you can accept the, you know, additional drop in FPS for additional beauty in this game, I think that'll be a very worthwhile trade-off in my own humble opinion. So I know I gave a very brief overview on the benchmark results. If you want me to go into more in depth using Cinebench and other systems like that, let me know. I didn't want to do it in this video because I thought maybe it might make the video a little too long. But leave me a comment if you liked it. If you want me to make more videos and more testing with this system, just let me know. Even if you want me to swap out some of the Xeon chips for other ones and see how it does. But overall, yes, you could use a dual CPU setup. Would I recommend it? No. Unless you've got some of the components laying around and you have easy access to some of the bits and pieces that you need, then maybe you could give it a try. But I think 95% of people, you're probably worthwhile just going for a single CPU setup and following that route. But if you're feeling adventurous, do what I did, build something unique and different. And to be honest, this is going to be my daily runner, even though it will be sucking a hell of a lot of watts out of my wall. So I'll leave you with the rest of this footage, and I hope you like the video. See you in the next one.